welcome to This Old Tree, a show that features heritage trees and their human stories. You'll hear interviews with experts, historians, and regular folks to celebrate the myths and uncover the real tales. This Old Tree is sponsored by Schwartz Tree and Landscaping in Cranston, Rhode Island. Professional tree service, landscaping, and plant management. Visit SchwartzTreeCare.com or call 401-941-4440. Now, here is your host, Doug Still.
I'm Doug Still, and I've got a lot of fun planned for you today as we reflect back on some of the people we met during the first 18 episodes and the tree stories they shared. I'm going to be playing songs about trees, at least some songs that I like. As a child of the 70s, I'll definitely be showing my age by some of my selections. But it turns out that there are certain themes surrounding old trees in their stories that pop up again and again in songs and in our collective imagination. In addition, you are going to get to meet Dee Lee, the person who wrote and sang our theme song. Sit back and enjoy this music-filled episode of This Old Tree.
This old tree, standing here for more than four centuries. Wonder what you'd say if you could talk to me about what it's like to be this old tree.
Since our very first episode about the Betsy Williams sycamore, old trees have been a source of comfort and shelter to people in need in our stories. Think of the pioneers taking refuge under the birthing tree in central Tennessee on their way westward, or Robin Hood's men hiding from the authorities in Sherwood Forest neath what's now known as the Major Oak, or the escape from the hot Florida sun provided by the shade of the Edison Banyan tree. Trees were pivotal within our evolution. Our prehistoric ancestors lived in trees, which provided protection from predators. Comfort and shelter was central in the very last episode, Texas Shade, the Founder's Oak. Here's what guest Kelly Ebby had to say.
The tree is a little less than 50 feet tall and has a 100-foot wide canopy spanning in different directions. It's just kind of just creates like a cover, a canopy, a roof, where you feel like you are secure under the shelter of that tree. And so with two main branches that come out.
Here's a great song by Van Morrison called The Redwood Tree, which is about a boy who lost his dog, which his father helped him search for. I think the redwood in this song is a lovely metaphor for both physical and emotional protection.
Boy and his dog went out looking for the rainbow. You know what did they learn? Since that very day, walking by the river and running like a blue streak through the fields and streams and meadows, laughing all the way. The redwood tree.
heritage tree is a living connection to the past, but to add to that, there can be very strong cultural associations as well. Trees can be symbols of bigger ideas, such as progress, art, or religion. They can provide affirmation of cultural identity. The imperial pine was a gift from Japan to the U.S. that represented a peace offering decades after World War II. The elm tree in Concord, Massachusetts that Henry David Thoreau wrote about symbolized, to him, the higher ideals of the past, as well as a burgeoning sense of pride in his young nation. In our show about the major oak of Sherwood Forest, guest Richard Townsley, known some days as the Sheriff of Nottingham, feels that visiting the 1,100-year-old oak tree associated with Robin Hood continues to be a cultural rite of passage.
It's just absolutely part of my heritage. It's part of my personal upbringing. And as I say, I've got two granddaughters. One is three, the other's not yet one. And I'm looking forward to bringing the second one here. I think they're not a Townsley until they've been into Sherwood, until they've dressed up as Robin Hood and they've run around and we've had a picnic. And so I'm very looking forward. Her name's Edith and she lives in Bath. We were discussing her being christened. She's going to be christened in a church in Bath. But I think for me, the christening will be when we bring her to the forest and introduce her to the major oak. So it's part of my family and my personal heritage.
I'm a big fan of the Australian band Crowded House. The song I'm about to play is about the memory of a lost relationship that began in England but transplanted to Australia. It's called English Trees.
For her, once upon a time.
Stories about trees sometimes center around hope rising above terrible adversity. The first 9/11 survivor trees were symbols of resilience after that unthinkable act of terrorism that shook New York City, Washington, D.C., and the country. Their replanting and survival was a gesture to the future and better times. We found similar themes in the tale of the birthing tree and also the founder's oak. In our episode, Harlem's Tree of Hope, about a street tree that became a good luck charm to black performers in the 1920s looking for their big break, Abra Lee beautifully expressed that the Harlem community reclaimed the symbolism around trees while creating their own modern, hopeful culture.
The connection to the tree is certainly ancestral, it's communal. I think of trees, of black people gathering under these mighty oak trees in the South that are along the river and having baptism. I think about people having full-on church up under these trees. I think about the first reading of the Emancipation Proclamation stating that the Civil War was over and that slavery was no longer legal in the United States happens under a tree. So that is where community happens for many black people. Tuskegee, one of the greatest universities in the United States, certainly the historic HBCU, historically black college and university, is built on a former plantation, you know, covered in trees at that time. So trees are, I think about them almost like you think about the grand ceilings of these churches all across the world in Europe. That's what that canopy is to people, to black people, and in these places where we can gather and feel free and be our unapologetic selves and speak in the language that we want to speak and the street slang. You know, this is where we can create music. This is where we can exchange words and ideas. So that is why that was important to that community. And honestly, I still would argue to this day.
Listen to this lovely song by Louis Armstrong with Gordon Jenkins and his orchestra, Trees.
That I shall never see a poem as lovely as a tree. A tree whose hungry mouth is bread. Against the earth, sweet flowing breath. Oh, tree that loves and guards all day and lives a leafless arms to break. A tree that made summer wear, yes, a nest of robins in her hair, upon whose bosom snow has lain. Intimately lives with rain beavers. But only God.
When we come back from a break, I'll continue our look back with season one guests and bring you more songs about trees. I'm Doug Still, and you're listening to This Old Tree. Hi, I'm Doug Still, and we're back with This Old Tree. Standing up against the big guy always makes a great story, whether it's the king's henchman in the Charter Oak tale, the sheriff of Nottingham in the Major Oak of Sherwood Forest, or the profit-seeking corporations featured in the Bronte Oak, or in Luna Indoors, a redwood's survival tale. It turns out the story about Luna the Redwood was our most popular episode. Who can resist hearing about a 2-year tree sit and its aftermath? Here's Stuart Moskowitz, the lead monitor of the Luna Covenant struck with the logging company.
That was New Year's Day, 1997. And yes, that's what, and they continued to log up on that hillside in the vicinity of the mudslide. And that's what attracted Earth First to target that hillside for a tree sit. And Luna was the largest tree. And so different activists they rotated sitting in Luna for several months in early 1997. And it was towards the end of 1997 when Julia Butterfly Hill, a young woman who was recovering from an automobile accident, 23 years old, and looking for something to change her, you know, she knew that she felt a calling to come out to do something in the redwood forests. The platform that was put 180 feet up in Luna and installed during the dark of night, which is where the name Luna came from, meaning moon, because that platform was built in the moonlight. Julia volunteered to take a turn up at the top of Luna. She had never climbed a tree before, but they showed her how to climb, and she got herself up to the top. And I think what made Julia different from the other tree sitters is that she is articulate and could speak to the cause well. And once she started talking and people started listening, she stayed.
One song that speaks to me about California and the questioning of tree loss is Big Yellow Taxi by Joni Mitchell. Love this song.
They paved paradise, put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. Seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone. They paid paradise, put up a parking lot. They took all the trees, put them in a tree museum, and they charged the people $1.50 just to see them. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. Hey, farmer, put away the DDT now. Give me spots on apples, or leave me the birds and the bees. Please, don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. Late last night, I heard the screen door slam, and a big yellow taxi took away my old man. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you've got till it's gone? They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. Seem to go, but you don't know what you've got till it's gone. They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. They paved paradise, put up a parking lot. They paved paradise, put up a parking lot.
Someone has to speak for the trees. How about the 87-year-old retired school teacher in Oakville, Ontario, who spoke at regional council to save the 200-plus-year-old Bronte oak tree from a road widening project? Her advocacy turned the tide of public perception and saved the tree, as told by guest and Oakville councillor Alan Elgar.
But you also have an 87-year-old woman named Joyce Burnell who came and spoke at the region. And a very colorful speech she gave to the region. She was the one that convinced the counselors. I sent out something about the oak tree, and she responded back to me and said, "What you're trying to do, I don't know you, but what you're trying to do, I really like, and I like what you're trying to do." And she had been a teacher all of her life, a school teacher, and she said, "I'll do that." So, and she did. It was unbelievably beautiful. When she spoke, who was going to argue with an 87-year-old woman that was so passionate? And she broke into a song singing, "Save our oak, God save our great oak tree," and everything. That we have to save this tree. It's an important tree. It's historic. There's hardly any left in Oakville at all. They've all been cut down for massive ship, years and years ago. It was here it was a seedling in 1760, and there's no way this tree should be cut. We have to save it.
The King of Trees by Cat Stevens, now Yusuf Islam, is about the exact same thing, losing a noble tree to a road project.
He was the king of trees, keeper of the glades. The way he lightened my life makes me so amazed. We used to meet by him many years ago. I loved you. Now I've come to lay the road.
For some people, a tree can bring back memories of a time in life when inner thoughts were important and growth happened. Maybe this occurred while sitting below in the shade, or better yet, climbing up into its branches. We've had a series of tree story shorts submitted by listeners, which we're still accepting, by the way, if you feel the inspiration. Here's a bit of one tree story short submitted by author Gil Revel.
Early on, I was able to scramble into every area of the tree, into both of the asymmetrical branch networks. At the top of one was a thick horizontal crook that served as a sort of hammock. I could lounge there, close to the sky, largely invisible from earthbound humans. As a kid, I was an inveterate reader, so there are pictures of me in my apple tree aerie, engrossed in a book. I remember being called down to the dinner table, but leaving books up there so I could get to them later. But I think this solitary backyard apple tree represented a refuge, providing vital and necessary aid to my early physical development, yeah, but also helping to foster my imagination. The view from up there provided perspective. My ground-level problems and preoccupations appeared puny. I could dream freely.
One of my favorite all-time songs is about inner turmoil while watching others get to freely climb the trees. This is Boys in the Trees by Carly Simon. So beautiful. And oh yeah, that's James Taylor on guitar.
Standing, passing down from myself and hope someone will see.
One thing everyone can relate to is that trees are a place to meet. They serve as neighborhood landmarks for locals or council trees for First Nation tribes. One of our episodes focused on the birthing tree, a huge white oak with a spreading canopy in McMinnville, Tennessee. Guest Tom Simpson explains.
Well, the way the story is that many of the old settlement trails in Tennessee, one of them was called the Kentucky Trail. The other one was called the Old Walton Trail, which was in Middle Tennessee. This tree stands in Middle Tennessee. But the confluence of several of those trails came right up under the birthing tree. And so as settlers would move down the trail going toward Alabama or coming back from Alabama going toward Kentucky or Virginia, they knew about this place. They had it as a meeting place for many, many years. And so parties would wait for other parties to hook up with them on the trail. And as they were waiting, some of the women would deliver babies underneath the trees, hence the name birthing tree.
Here's a fun song about meeting at a tree, in this case for love. This is The Mango Tree by the Zac Brown Band featuring Sarah Bareilles.
Sunlight to come rising from the sea. We lay undercover, shaded by the mango tree. We could stay forever, never leave this paradise. Swaying in the ocean breeze to the rhythm of the tide. Tomorrow. You love me too. We can turn the whole world upside down. Just us two. Nobody else will do. 'Cause baby, you're the only one for me. Underneath the mango tree.
Sticking to our bodies just like sugar on our skin. The day is getting older, oh, but we are still so young. Higher than the stars above and faded like the sun.
Tomorrow, oh, tomorrow. Take your time. You love me too. we can turn the whole world upside down. Just us two. Underneath the mango tree. Just us two.
It's me and you.
Nobody else will do. Baby, you're the only one.
Baby,
for me. Baby, you're the only one.
Baby,
for me.
You're the only one for me.
Underneath the mango tree.
Speaking of songs about trees, you know our theme song? Yeah, that's the one. Well, it was written and sung by a fellow arborist in Illinois named Dee Lee. After the break, we're going to meet him and find out what makes him tick. Coming up on This Old Tree. Hi, I'm Doug Still, and we're back with This Old Tree. Dee, how are you?
I'm terrific.
Thanks so much for joining the show.
Oh, my pleasure. My pleasure indeed. It's been a great joy to watch your journey, and it's just wonderful to tune in. So I'm a big fan.
You know, people tell me all the time they love your song, This Old Tree, which you've allowed to be our theme song. And when it comes on at the beginning, some people tell me, you know, they like to sing along.
Oh, no kidding. Oh, that's a wee bit for me heart.
Yeah. So I thought it would be great for listeners to get to know you a little bit. And I've introduced you on the show as an arborist and a songwriter. Which comes first?
Songwriter actually came first. I was,
really?
It actually was my next door neighbors, this wonderful family called the Berries, and they had four or five children, all of them musical. Mother and father were musical. And their whole family, you know, between them, I don't know how many instruments they knew how to play.
This is when you were a kid?
Yes. We lived right next door to them. As a matter of fact, the boy whose age was closest to mine was named Lee Berry, and they were thinking of naming me Barry Lee because I was 1 year younger than him. They were wonderful harmonists. You know, they could harmonize, they could play.
Really, a whole family, kind of like the Carter family or something.
Yeah. And they would do a mamas and a papas with all the harmonies and the guitars. And I remember one night hearing that, and I was just thunderstruck. I knew I had to learn how to do that.
Wow. And so you learned guitar as a boy?
Yes. Yeah. My cousins also were guitarists, and we would vacation with them. And one of them brought a guitar up to the vacation spot, a little place across Lake Michigan, and they made the mistake of teaching me one chord.
Oh yeah, that first one is I play guitar.
Yes,
I'm amateur, but there's something about that first chord, and you're like, I made that sound.
Yes, and it goes right into your chest, and oh boy, they finally had to send me upstairs because I was just playing an E and an E minor all night.
Yeah, you don't have to have a song, just play some chords. No. And then you kind of figure out how to tie them together.
That's right. You let it come to you.
You're a finger picker, which I try to do, but, you know, it's pretty inconsistent. Did you learn the finger picking technique when you were a kid also?
Well, that was, I'm not too sure when I started finger picking, but I think it was after hearing John Prine with his Travis picking. And I think I figured out how to do it. And then once I did that, it was just little experiments on, you know, moving things around. And I think it went off from there.
Right. How to move your thumb.
Yeah.
So then you needed a day job and you became an arborist.
Well, that came generations ago. My grandfather was a well-known nurseryman in the area, Ralph Sinisvet. Matter of fact, he has 6 or 7 patents on plants, which I get to see in my rounds as an arborist. I see something he created and hello, Grandpa.
Wow. So you're in Illinois.
Yes.
And what's the name of the nursery?
Ralph Sinistvet.
Sinistvet.
Yeah.
What were some of the cultivars they developed?
Well, he had a wonderful cornice moss. I can't remember the name of it. He had 2 varieties of Viburnum dentatum. I think one was Chicago Jazz, and I think another one might have been Luster. But he bred them out so that they were nicely thick leaves and could put up with Chicago winters. And then he had a locust. I don't think it was used much. I don't think it caught on much. It was the Green Glory locust. And then he had the most successful one, I think, was his low-grow sumac, or grow-low, one of those two. And I see that everywhere.
Is that along highways and stuff?
Yeah, it's a great ground cover. It's woody, so it can catch papers and things, kind of like Gattoni asters. But it's beautiful. I see it a lot in islands where it just covers up the island and the weeds say, no, I'm going somewhere else.
So trees were in your DNA early on as well.
Yes. And then my father, he went to Northwestern for literature on the GI Bill. And then he ended up as the head arborist he worked for my grandfather, and he married the boss's daughter. So that was more tree stuff. And then as soon as I was allowed to, I worked in the Christmas tree lot, selling Christmas trees and loading flowers and plants for clients in the retail shop. And then when I was old enough, I got up in the trees and I just loved it.
Yeah. So you're a climber. I know that because there's a picture of you on way up in the canopy of a tree on a branch with your guitar. And I can't see if you've got a harness on or anything like that. But anyway, you got the shot.
Yes, I did have a harness. And my one claim to fame was in 1979, I was the all-around co-champion for the arborist competitions in Illinois for the Midwestern states.
You had there was a climbing competition.
Yeah, they have them every year, and they have regions, and then the best get to go and be champions of the world, I guess, the universe.
Congratulations. What year was that?
1979.
Fantastic. Yeah. We had the ISA International Climbing Competition here in Providence in 2009. I remember that. It was lots of fun to watch. You know, the climbers would go up and grab flags out of the tree. And there was an aerial rescue competition, all kinds of things.
That's exactly what it was. Although back in my day, there wasn't an aerial rescue. I'm glad they added that. But it was the same thing where you had to go touch the bell on 5 flags. And then you had to get down and they timed you. And then there was a log drop competition and a rope throw and a chainsaw event.
Wow, you're very talented.
Well, like I said, it's genetic, I guess.
Back to songwriting, or actually, let's get to songwriting. What was the first song you ever wrote?
Well, it was very complicated. I think it was two words and two chords, and nobody wanted to hear it.
Got to start somewhere.
Exactly. And I think there was another one I wrote while I was sitting under the piano. One of my sisters was practicing or something, and I thought of something there. And then my grandmother, who was a music teacher, she was a Burnham, actually related to Daniel Burnham. And my mother thought, well, he has a love of music. Let's send him over to grandma for a music lesson or two. And I was kind of high energy. And grandma got through one lesson with me. And that was the lessons that I had.
That was it.
That was enough. Yeah.
So then you became self-taught?
Yeah. Because I immediately wanted to take whatever it was she showed me and make a song out of it. I've always had melodies that just seem to want to come out, and just following my nose through them and then trying to learn the chords that support them. And so I've always, you know, I should have spent more time learning other people's beautiful music, but the drive for me has always been to get a guitar in my hand and I just start tinkering and playing around with it.
That's wonderful. This song's about a tree, but what other kinds of things do you write about?
I have some inspirational, you would call it, sort of general uplifting spiritual. I think I have about 30 of those. And lots of nature things. Trees seem to get into most of my songs.
I was going to ask you, are there any other songs about trees? So there are quite a few of them, huh?
Well, there's some that have nature and trees in them. I've got three that are specifically now about trees. I have this old tree, one called The Roots, which is, you know, just kind of a simple one to help people understand roots a little better. And then there's one called Amber. I always fell in love with the idea that, you know, amber was actually a product of a tree that is millions of years old. So that was sort of romantic. So I wrote one about that too.
Yeah. Could you play a few bars?
Sure.
I was hoping you'd say that.
Sure, I'll give it a try. I haven't played this one in a while, so you'll have to forgive me if it's rusty, but I'll tell you what, how about I play The Roots? That's a fun one. It's kind of a choppy, fun song. It has a precipitation where it's a call and response where I go, it's The Roots. And people go, it's The Roots. Anyway, it's very fun to play live.
Okay.
All right, we'll try here. Here we go. This is called The Roots.
I'm interjecting here. The live recording technology didn't go so well. So here's another live recording of the song, It's The Roots, that Dee sent me afterward.
There's buried treasure under every tree. Let's dig it up together, solve this mystery.
Here you go.
It's The Roots.
It's The Roots.
Well, the song This Old Tree is about a tree that has been a witness to history. What inspired you?
Yes, I just wanted to start writing songs about trees. And I had this vision of it might have been New England or it might have been an imaginary cove on Lake Michigan, where there was a small medieval town that grew up around this tree that was in the center of the town. And it was big enough that even the boats coming in from offshore could see the top of it and, you know, use it as a reference point. And I just tried to put that into a song.
That's interesting because, yeah, there's a line in the song about boats.
Yeah, that's what it is.
I didn't know quite what that meant, if it was along the seacoast or something.
Yes, that's exactly right. It was a sentinel, you know, that they could see it's the top of its foliage from out far enough that they could use it as a bearing.
That's great. One thing I like about the song is when it gets to maybe the third verse, after the third verse, the chorus comes in again and you just raise the volume a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's really a moving part of the song.
Well, thank you. How did you like the bridge?
Yeah, it gets a little dark almost.
It does, doesn't it?
Into a minor key? No.
Yeah. Yeah, it feels minor to me. It feels
a lot of minor chords.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm playing songs that mention trees today on this episode. Do you have a favorite song about a tree or a forest, perhaps?
No, not really. Not one that comes to mind. But I'm excited to hear what you're going to put in.
If someone wishes to discover more of your music and maybe download some of your music, where should they go?
Okay. You can download all of it for free. All you have to do is leave me an email and you won't get any spam because I hardly ever send anything out. But it's dleetree.com, and that's 6 E's. So it's dleetree.com.
And they can download for free?
Absolutely. I'm tickled pink if anyone goes and takes a look. And I don't have all my music there, but I have enough of it so you can browse around and enjoy yourself.
Fantastic. Well, from the moment I met you on the phone a year and a half ago, you've been just so friendly and charming, and we instantly became buddies. And I love the song, and it's been an honor to have it on the show every week, and it inspires me to keep going.
Well, it's been my utter pleasure, and I'm so grateful that you found it. I think I always hope that my music goes somewhere where it can be useful and people can enjoy it, and I'm just really grateful that you found a place for it on your wonderful podcast.
Thank you very, very much for coming on the show. And now let's listen to the song in its entirety. I can't think of a better way to end season one. And just before we do, I'd like to thank you, tree lovers, for joining me on this journey this past year. I'm tremendously grateful that you listen, and the comments you send either via email or Facebook or Instagram are greatly appreciated too. Thanks to everyone who has contributed and supported the show in one way or another. Season 2 is going to be even better. I can't wait to share some of the ideas and the tree stories that are in the works. I'm Doug Still, and without further ado, here's Dee Lee singing what's become the theme song to This Old Tree.
This old tree, standing here for more than 4 centuries. Wonder what you'd say if you could talk to me about what it's like to be this old tree. Shadow and shade, kids down the block are selling lemonade. Send them down a cool breeze, a sweet cascade, tailor-made by this old tree. In 1600, you were just a seed, reaching for the sky high, waiting for a chance to take your place in the warm sunshine. Here I go, high above the place where the people grow. Leave my troubles on the ground far below, so I can get to know this old tree. Summer sparkle in your leaves.
autumn winds will bring a release. Winter calls for you to sleep. Spring returns again in green. Above the town, ships on the water spy your royal crown. Sentinel of green, 2 points off starboard bow. Homeward bound to this old tree. In 1800 you felt the thunder roll, and lightning split the sky high. Though the fire raged in the little town below, you managed to survive. With the scar upon your side, this old tree, reach out and touch a living history. Beneath my hands an ancient mystery. How small I am by this old tree. How small I am by this old tree.
Thank you for listening to This Old Tree. This Old Tree is sponsored by Schwartz Tree and Landscaping in Cranston, Rhode Island. Professional tree service, landscaping, and plant management. Visit SchwartzTreeCare.com or call 401-941-4440.